Between Two Beers podcast. My name's Steve Holloway. In this first episode, we speak with former All-White and Waikato football celebrity Aaron Scott. It's a new show, so we're trying a few new things. If you like what you're hearing, contact me, stephen.holloway@nzherald.co.nz, or check out our Between Two Beers Facebook page. I had a great chat with Aaron, just over an hour. We wide-ranging conversation. We spoke about his time with Roy Krishna at Waitakere before he turned pro, life with four kids in a budding football career. And we talked about his time with the All Whites and the way he was mismanaged by some of the staff following the 2010 World Cup qualifying win over Bahrain. So a great chat. Stick around and hope to see you again next time. My name's Steve Holloway, and sitting alongside me is Mr. Seamus Marten. For those of you who are listening in the football fraternity, you'll know Shay. He's a very effervescent character. He's a lot of fun. He's everywhere and anywhere. He actually started as a goalkeeper. Not a lot of people know that. He was a glovesman for Hamilton Boys High, First 11, Claudelands Rovers, and Narawahia. Before he realised it wasn't really his calling, goalkeeping, so he made his way into the admin side, where he's really thrived. He's worked for Oceania Football Confederation as their competitions manager. He's worked at FIFA World Cups. Most recently, he was a CEO of an under-20 Women's World Cup in Papua New Guinea. He's gone from strength to strength. He's worked in New Zealand football too. Most recently, the All Whites international team manager. Worked very closely with Fritz Schmidt, rest in peace. And he's worked with Melbourne United too. They got to the Channel Cup final this year. He was the manager there. So a lot of strings to his bow, but also a bloody good interviewer. So Shay, welcome along, and look forward to this journey with you.
Are we just going to do the podcast on me? That was illustrious.
You like that?
It was very good.
Yeah.
Very good, Stephen.
Been practicing.
Well, I guess maybe I'll just speak a little about you before we move on to Aaron. Stephen Holloway, flat track bully, Waikato FC all-time leading goal scorer, Melville United third on the all-time list, overtaken by Mark Evans, another flat track bully. Three-time Northern Premier League winner? Have I got that right?
Why don't we say? Why don't we go ahead and say four?
I don't know. Is it four?
Yeah, we'll say four. Two with Bad Olympic, one with Glenfield, one with Melbourne.
Melbourne didn't count because the Northern Region clubs win in the league.
Well, there was a final and we won the final. So
yeah, well, it wasn't really a real.
Wow. Anyway, there's a trophy and there's a big picture in the Melbourne club rooms. So
one of the more little-known facts about Stephen, a glovesman himself, but in the cricket game, Northern Districts, under-15, wicketkeeper.
Yeah, not a lot of people know that.
And Wim Hof enthusiast, for those that are up to date with breathing and cold showering techniques.
Health and wellness.
Yep. Yeah. You're big on that now.
You, me.
Yep. And probably one of the most cultured persons I know. Cultured persons? Cultured people.
Try people.
Cultured people that I know. But, again, and probably a very, very underrated media man and adding podcasts to your skill set.
Okay. Well, let's not blow too much smoke up each other's asses because we do have our flaws, but the man sitting alongside me perhaps doesn't. Aaron Scott. Now, Aaron was a little bit like a little brother to me growing up. He was a few years younger at Boys High. Well, we played First 11 together when I made the final of the Chatham Cup in 2003. He'd been cup-tied, so he couldn't take the field, but he was along, and you could see with his silly little dirty dog glasses on the sideline. And
maybe
had braces, I'm not sure. Anyway, he was kind of like the up-and-comer until he became the master, really. Sort of overtook us all. Went on to, I can't even. Did you do your research? How many national leagues has he won with Waitakere?
Four.
And how many club OFC Champions League titles?
Zero.
Wow. You and the infamous Papua New Guinea match.
Losses in the final.
Oh Wow. The Auckland City.
Sorry to bring that up. Yeah. But he's a man of the people.
Team Wellington. Another loss. Sorry.
Sorry. You know, I'm still in the intro stage. Because there's a lot to cover. He started making his way up and he kept playing for Waitak and he kept winning titles. And then the All Whites came. And then he was an All White. And then it was international caps. And then there was the Bahrain game and he was there. And I remember all the...
Don't forget the Olympics.
The Olympics. So there's a lot going on. But the thing is, he's still going.
Is he still going?
Well, he played in the Chatham Cup final.
Yeah, I was there.
For God's sakes.
And you were there.
And he's got four kids. Can you imagine four children? Seems a lot. I've got two young kids and I can't imagine what four's like, let alone still playing football with four. So we're going to get into that. But yeah, bloody good guy. One of the nice guys in football. Up there with, you say, your Wayne Bates, who's his brother-in-law, the two nicest men. And there's a lot we want to get into, a lot of nitty-gritty. So, Shay, how do you know as...
I think I first came across Aaron in the year 2000. I'd left Hamilton Boys High, first year university. I want to say it was a Galloway Park training session, Hamilton Boys High. I'd been roped in by maybe Dr. Wilcox to do some coaching. And I quickly learnt that really wasn't my calling and just got out of that. And then I think the next... interaction was possibly in my two-game cameo for the Melville first team, post-Eddie Trubshoe red card headbutting Michael Main in the Hamilton Derby. 2004 or 2005. I'd moved to Auckland. I was playing for Metro. It wasn't great. Eddie got sent off. I got a call from your dad, Bruce Holloway, asking if I was available. I transferred the next week. I played two games, one at home, one away. I think away was, I want to say, Waitamata. Might have played three games, actually, because I remember playing at Birkenhead as well.
This is a bit more about you than Aaron, isn't it?
Yeah, again.
We're trying to...
That's where I came across Aaron. Okay,
yeah. I knew we'd get there.
I think he was playing. It might not have been. I don't know. It's more sort of about me. And then New Zealand teams. I was the OFC competitions coordinator at the Olympic qualifiers 2012. You were there actually, Stephen, as well, in a media capacity. Prior to flying out to Papua New Guinea for the world's worst.
I missed out on that squad.
Now it seems
Sam
like
Messam. If you're listening,
you're making it about you now.
You took my spot.
And then, peripheral until I came back to Hamilton and got involved with Will Kane with the Melville first team, and then spent the last 2 years just playing songs in the dressing room.
Okay. Well, I think that's a pretty solid intro. Let's get into it. As first question, are you retired? Have you retired? Because, and I'll tell you why. At the end of last season, my father, Bruce Holloway, put a story on the Melville website, and at the bottom, the last two pars, one of them said Michael Main and Sam Wilkinson have left the club. They're doing their own thing. Sam going to Phoenix. Main's doing his age group New Zealand coaching, and Aaron Scott has played his last game. I won't be returning. And I thought, has he actually said that, Bruce? Or have you taken a few liberties with the pen there, as he does at times? So what's going on?
It's undecided yet, to be honest, Stephen. So thanks for the welcome to the podcast, and some very good intros there. More for Seamus on myself, but like the book's not closed. What capacity it will be a different scenario. So maybe more on that later on. But the Melville chapter's not finished in my own autobiography. We're waiting to see what direction it goes and what fills those pages yet. But I have not decided that. The website supposedly has.
Cheers, Bruce.
I have not decided that myself.
I didn't think it was right, but no. He's definitely got at least 1 year.
You don't want to go out on a game like that, do you? Well, that's got final loss.
The agreement before the game, if we won, that was definitely it.
Yep.
Go out on a high, can't go better than it. We did contemplate, and I got asked the question, what if you lose? And obviously didn't want to think about it. We said,
who asked that question?
My better half, I'm not going to lie.
Right.
My wonderful wife, Chrissy, who's at home at the moment with the four kids. But, it was undecided if we lost, and obviously we did. History will tell you that, but There's been no comment on the playing side yet, or any other side for that matter.
I feel like the way these things work is if you're not coming back, you're making a very firm decision late in the piece. I'm talking your Februarys, your Marches, your Aprils. If you're already on the fence about maybe I will, maybe I won't, in the start of November, you're definitely playing. He's definitely playing.
Gav Douglas, isn't it? Yeah. It's Gav Douglas.
A couple more.
Yeah.
Because when you retire, you always come back for another little nibble.
Yeah. Yeah. The playing fires are still burning. If it's a different role within the playing structure and club structure, which may be, but there are maybe offers from other Hamilton clubs.
Wow! Exclusive! Wow!
I was going to ask you about
one of
that.
Your old mentors for both you, Paul Nixon.
What?
A great chat from the Claudelands Rovers legend of Paul Nixon.
Is in a coaching capacity? Shout out.
No, just a straight up Claudelands Rovers stalwart. Capacity.
Well, your dad's Rovers.
Dad's a Rovers through and through. I played for Rovers when I was 12 with the bunch of our Waikato rep mates that we grew up playing together. We all went
Josh Keeney's.
Your Josh Keeney's, Tim Richardson's, Michael Sugar's is one for the bat. Yeah,
that would blow the minds out of the Melville faithful.
Oh, it definitely would.
As in his in the twilight of his career, the last season signed. You've only played for one.
Well, you've just hit twilight now.
Have you?
Yeah, usually mean doesn't it?
Have you only played for one
winter club?
Winter correct. Club.
One winter club.
Your whole career. Correct. And then the last season you're gone.
We had the little Hamilton Wanderers National League.
Summer.
How was that?
Interesting, I'll be honest. Obviously coming back from...
Did it feel weird wearing blue?
Yes, I'm not going to lie. Yeah. And, if you notice, I don't try and wear blue. Now I'm wearing blue shorts.
Shorts to a different story.
Gang thing.
But, yeah, it was interesting. Came back from Waitak after hanging my boots up there, losing probably the fourth O-League final I'd lost. And myself, Pearce announced he was retiring. And I said, look, I can't do the trips to Auckland. We had one kid at that stage. Second one was in wife's stomach. And said, that's it. Yeah, said, that's it for me. Thanks. Obviously, Waitak gave me a hell of a lot in terms of getting me to places I'd only dream of. And fulfilled that dream and thought, no, look, reality has to kick in here. I'm teaching full time. I can't travel up 3-4 times a week to Auckland. And back to in those days, Wybop United.
I was there actually. Sorry to make this about me again. I was the team manager.
I was disappointed that you didn't mention it because you basically held that team together with glue.
Stop it, I'll blush.
Wybop failed after going to Waitak, and that was the biggest failure going back there.
Right.
I still want to play, go to Wanderers for 2 seasons, and then realise, look, that's the International League for me.
Was it 2 seasons at Wanderers?
I'm sure it was 2 seasons.
Wowee.
Yeah, 2 seasons.
So when you were going back and forth the motorway for Waitak, at your peak, was that 4 times a week?
First season, so believe it or not, went 5 times. We'd go up Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday training, Saturday morning, then the Sunday game.
There and back, or stay there and night?
No, there and back all the time.
Wow.
So that was.
And how many?
What car? Sorry.
Hang on, Jay. One at a time. How many kids? How many kids did you have?
No kids. So this was 2000.
Do what you want.
End of 2008.
Freedom.
Finished studying. I used to work for a good family friend who's godfather to one of the children, Jimmy Lennon. So I worked for him for 3 or 4 hours, train, rest, sleep, and drive. Train.
Can I ask my question now?
Yeah.
What car were you?
It was actually a Nissan Ford Telstar.
They'll go all day. Looking
for sponsorship if there's anyone from Ford.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Chalk Ks on that. So you're talking...
The whole 5 years?
150 Ks trip-ish.
Yep.
Way out west from the opposite side of Hamilton here. And 5 times a week, chalked up Ks.
What time are you coming home?
Oh, late. So the best part of it was... sharing a car with Danny Robinson, we'd share trips, so sometimes he'd drive in his Holden, would get there a lot quicker, obviously. And then after about a month, he went, stuff this and moved to Auckland.
Yeah.
And worst part was it, the gaffer at the time, Chris Miller, said, you signed your contract, so your petrol thing's set, you can't go and change it. Yeah, and Robbo went, sorry, mate. And he had the same deal as me for petrol, and that was just one of the learning curves as a youngster going, okay, always look out for yourself, because, although they're good people, they won't sort of... Unfortunately, contracts bind you to things. So,
Stephen goes to Auckland most Mondays.
Yep.
And stops at Huntley KFC
on occasion.
What was your go-to stop in the early hours, or did you just beast at home?
It was always
a meal or something.
So it used to always be drive straight there?
Yeah.
Literally, you know, 2-3 hours because of Auckland traffic going through it from one end south to the northwest. But ended up buying through the internet one of those portable fridges that you plug into your cigarette lighter.
This is
that
mad.
Could heat it or cold it.
This is mental.
And worked for the first season. Thought it was awesome. Stored it.
Sounds awesome.
Stored it. Second season didn't work. And after that became the like peanut butter and jam sandwich, a Marmite sandwich.
This guy.
Servos of 2 minute noodles.
This guy.
Just, but at the same time, I didn't have a job. Wasn't married yet in the first season. And thought, I've got to do this without spending money. Because if you go every single training to fast food, it chalks up the price. And a couple of the young boys from Melbourne are finding that out now.
Chalks up the weight too, I'll have you know.
I'd assume so. probably good evidence of that, is it?
Yeah.
I'll take your word for it.
Yeah.
So fast forward a few years, you got two kids, but you're still doing it. You're still, how many days a week were you travelling up? After you had the kids?
So, obviously I had Ella Rose, the oldest, and still travelling up. So, she was born 2011, so played there till 2012, the end of that season. Then, back to Wanderers for 2 seasons. Oh, sorry, Waibot. Oh. Then went back to Waitak, so I had 2 kids, one more on the way. And, well, the end of that season was on the way, but that was the time going, what am I doing?
Yeah, so how many days
a week that became on, a Thursday only.
Ah.
Oh, so day one, if you want me, I'm coming Thursday only. You've rung me, I haven't rung you to play.
Yeah.
This is the agreement. That was probably, playing-wise, had a great group. Unfortunately for a couple of coaches that lasted 3 weeks, just we didn't put it together. And unfortunately, playing small-sided games and running all pre-season, then playing Auckland City in the first game, getting... Yeah. Thumped, went, oh shit, we got work to do.
I think we shared a season at Waitak, and I look back.
Pretty sure we did, to be fair.
Yeah, I think around 2012.
Is that the infamous eyebrows interview?
Yeah, it was.
If you get the chance, listeners, YouTube, Stephen Holloway, Waitakere, there is a good interview with Stephen. No, I think it was a preview stuff.
Cold classic, Terry Matterford and Shane Wenslick. Yeah. But I think of that team, and I remember being quite frustrated because I couldn't. Break in.
Yep, I second that. We all fought to be fair.
But then I look at that team now, and the guys I was behind, Roy Krishna and Ryan DeVries and Allan Pearce.
And Gargamy Finney.
Oh, Gargamy, yeah. Maybe not so much Gargamy.
Absolute freestyle baller, though. Great for the fans.
But I was like, what a front line. And then you had Jake Butler and yourself and Timmy Myers and...
Jason Rowley
and yep. Marty Bullock was still playing.
Yeah, ex-Premier League star Martin Bullock.
Shit,
it's a bit of a shame
as a team
when you think about them to where they are currently.
Yeah, big change.
Yeah, the caliber of the history. I think a lot of people forget that history that they have won
the Embers
four titles,
four in a row.
Like Caney and Millie and all those guys won titles as well.
But what I wanted to ask you about that period, because you played with Roy before. He turned pro at age 27.
Yep.
But I remember when I was there, I was like, this guy is amazing. We used to train out of that turf field. And it was like, talking to Danny Robinson. I was saying, how is he playing at this level? He was lightning quick. He had a thunderous shot. His decision making was good. And it was kind of like everyone knew. It was like a little inside secret. Like, yeah, it's just a joke how good he is and how much he was tearing up the league. And no one wanted to take a chance on him. But you must have played with him for 3 or 4 years before he went. For
all 5 years I was at Waitak, he was there.
Did you know the whole time that he was too good for that level? Yeah, Did you know he was going to be as good as he became?
I'll be honest, I think I did. So I met him, we played a Football for Hope tour 2008 when I was still studying.
I organised that.
just clap your own balloon. But Roy was the striker, and I remember they had just played the under 20 qualifiers at Waitakere, and Jonathan Gould, the assistant coach, went, look, Aaron, you're going to mark this kid called Roy Krishna, be aware, he's fast. And everyone was talking him up. Everyone in New Zealand was like, he's going to be the next big thing. This was 2008. Then he came to Waitakere, they brought him over, and history will tell you, look, Roy bailed us out of game after game. I remember one particular one playing Hawke's Bay, nil all, 88th minute. He gets the ball on halfway, skins whoever was left back, ran around the other centre back, cut him, left foot, pile drive to the top corner of the far side. We won 1-0, and we're going, thank goodness we had Roy. And players like that, I guess you'd say, they come around once a generation, but we had Roy, we had Allan Pearce and Benjamin Totori, where marking and training was tough.
Yeah.
But you learned to hone your craft because they were that good, where the rest of the league would be, without being disrespectful, some of them weren't up to that standard, and they all had different attributes. But look, Roy was one there, either foot, balance, pace, the tenacity, the fight, and you always knew he was going to go somewhere. It was literally when. Oh, he's back this year. Brilliant for us. Yeah. Mate, what's going on? No one calls Phoenix come around after the Knights and things.
It's one of the great shames, because you've lost about 6 years. I mean, he should have been at 20. Because
yeah.
I think he actually lost a little bit of pace.
He looked to the Phoenix. Someone else told me that too. He got slower at the Phoenix.
A little bit. But
he bulked up, so it's one of those fine.
Yeah, but you think if he had had another 6 years where he could have ended up, if he had done what he did from age 26, from age 20 to 26, and then he's got another 5-6 years.
Yeah. And you wonder, could he have gone further in the A-League, Stephen? So rather than now playing Indian Premier League in the game day last night.
So I've got a question for you. So you've kind of got Totori and Krishna are the two island success stories that have sort of cracked the A-League. Maybe you might go Collins, Manapi.
Would you say Benji cracked the A-League?
Well, if you're listening, Benji, I love you, but I don't know whether you did crack.
No, made it to the A-League. Started some games in
Collins,
the
A-League. I'll give you comments.
Where I'm going with this is they had vastly different experiences when they had the A-League. So Totori was a flop, but Krishna was a huge success. Yep. So my question is Tommy Semmy. We have seen a lot of him here because for some reason he's playing Northern Premier League for Wanderers every year, and he seems to me head and shoulders above the rest, especially as a striker. Where does he sit for you in that sort of scale of Totori to Krishna? Could he get as good as Krishna? Would he just be the same as Totori if he...
I'm only going to speak from other people's opinions here. Well, I've played him once, obviously he scored the winner against Melbourne day dot in the season, then played in the second game and he was non-existent. But the boys tell me he doesn't drink, he's shredded. He's only 23 or something, is that correct?
Yeah.
He's only young, isn't he?
But
look, he's got absolute turn of pace, shot, he's strong. Absolutely can dribble with the boys. I was quite surprised the Phoenix didn't take him as one of those, hey, look, we can put him on the last 10, 20 minutes in the game. Look what he can do.
Mm.
Or we're playing our way to, Melbourne City, top of the league. We'll give him a chance.
Mm.
But I'm surprised he's not elsewhere, I'll be honest. Because if you look at, like you just said, consistently over the last three seasons, he's been nearly golden boot in the Northern Prem or there or thereabouts. Wins all the sort of MVP votes.
Mm.
Fan favourite. The people at Wanderers love him, the families and whatnot. He's absolute heart of gold from what I've heard.
Mm.
I've only talked to him a couple of times, and he's just a genuine top bloke from what I know. And that's based on mostly other people's opinions, and some of those opinions I'd back, obviously ones that I trust. But I'll be honest, I'm surprised he's still here.
You've seen a bit of him, Shay. You've got some contacts in the Papua New Guinea football world. Where do you put him on that sliding scale?
Yeah, I think similar. I think he... There's probably a rawness about him, which I think Roy probably had.
Yeah.
Rory Fallon. I don't think of Rory Fallon.
He's not raw.
Well, he's cultured. Rory. Yeah, it's the beers.
Good beer, by the way.
Yeah, I'm surprised. Yeah, it is. We're looking for a beer partner. Beer partner, if anyone out there is listening. I think I'm no coach. You probably need Will Kane or someone like that to come on there, but maybe a little bit of game understanding is still to come. I don't know, like his background in football in Papua New Guinea is pretty raw. But to have those natural gifts, I think you can't. Someone famously said you can't coach pace.
I like the argument going, well, do you put him in an environment where he can get there and then see what he's capable of and give him a couple of
minutes? I think so, yeah.
And that's my opinion. It's the same with Roy.
Maybe if anyone out there is thinking about becoming, you know, a budding player intermediary or an athlete representative.
That's who you want.
At this point, I think we should mention Shay is, looking for opportunities?
Canvassing.
There's a lot of, obviously, this podcast is going to virally spread through the football community. So if you're looking for a guy who knows a thing or two about a thing or two, Shay might be your man. But Shay, I want to really narrow down on this, and for both of you actually, I'm gonna put a sliding scale there. Okay, so
he loves a one to ten.
So that's more evidence to say where he's based.
I want to know exactly where you're putting him. So let's say once you've cracked it into the A League, Totori was a 1 out of 10. Krishna is a 10 out of 10.
I know, just for the sake of the scale. I roomed with Benji Great lad, great laugh.
I thought you only ever roomed with Allan Pearce.
No, we roomed, I remember it was only one night. We'd stayed in Auckland to fly out somewhere and I roomed with Benji. So I'm going Benji about a 6 out of 10.
Okay. What?
Not the only, just...
Well, I'm not asking you to judge his personality.
If you're saying Roy's a 10,
yeah.
Benji, although that's who he did work from.
Once he made... So, in the A-League.
It's not a 1.
Okay. Oh, all right, let's say...
Is that how your scale works?
Let's say he's a 3. Okay. We'll say he's a 3.
Yeah.
Where do you think Tommy Semmy, right now, if you put him in, would be on that scale?
6.
In between. Definitely in between.
6. Okay.
Okay. But it's hard to say because he hasn't got the chance. I'd love to see him get the chance and go, look, we told you he should have been there.
Mm.
And the Hamilton fraternity go, look, we had this player.
Can I just say something about the word fraternity?
You don't like
yeah,
that?
Go on.
Yeah, fraternity relates just to men. So you've got fraternity and sorority.
Okay, so what's a better word there?
Community.
I'm not an English teacher.
Community.
I'm not trying to be exclusive.
Well, you're being exclusive. You're excluding
the group. That's a fair call. So I apologise to the female listeners.
The female listeners like Tommy Semmy as well.
I've seen some of those pics with his shirt off. I think Gucci's been plastering them all over his Facebook page. He's got a rig.
Yeah.
I don't mind.
Yeah, he works
appreciating the male form.
Yeah, true.
You know, from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
So good on you. As I'll steer back to your Waitak days. So you've played with a lot of players, a lot of quality players.
Yep.
Was there anyone you played with who you thought, shit, this guy is gonna crack it, and never really did? They had all the...
He's fetching for a Ross McCormick.
Not Ross McCormick. Ross McCormick.
Sorry, Ross McCormick.
Yeah,
sorry.
No. Was there anyone? Because I look back to secondary school days and the guys that were in that team, who were the...
Is it just Waitak or is it...
Well, yeah, it could be anywhere, but I'm thinking most likely it might have been someone who came across.
Well, don't put words in his mouth.
I was thinking guys like Wayne. Do you remember Wayne Rooker? He was a superstar 16-year-old.
Went up to Papua New Guinea to work as a glazier.
Oh, yeah.
I tried to get him to play for Hikari. Again, I don't want to make this about me.
Yeah,
sort of. Isn't it?
But he didn't. But yeah, he was there.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah, I do remember
one of the names I remember listening to. This guy's going to be something.
Sanjay Singh.
Lewis Chaloner. That was one that I admired. Lewis Chaloner, Mag central midfielder, smashed me in a tackle.
Mm.
Whoa, he's going to be something. And another one went to the States. Who knows?
Yeah.
Disappeared.
What about Bill Tuiloma? Because you played with him when he was young.
Did you definitely.
You knew straight away that he was going to go to...
You said that didn't make it because Bill's...
I know, we've gone there because...
Was that the answer then?
Yeah, you turned the corner. You took over the question about yourself.
With Wayne Rooker.
Yeah. You made it about yourself and the islands again. I've spoken to you about that.
No, Bill was always mature and eager to learn. As a youngster, sometimes you get players that have that talent, but... are happy with it without really trying to strive for more or to learn and things. And not saying I was experienced at that time, but I think we had Martin Bullock at the time. We played in the Premier League and you could see just ooze class, even though he was about 38, weighed about 54 kgs, dripping wet. No, ones like that to learn off were invaluable. One player I thought that could have, I always fancied a Zane Sol.
Yes.
A big fan of Zane Sol.
Yeah.
Quads like tree trunks, strong.
You're not afraid to admire the male for me.
No, he was a beast. I was always glad he was in my team.
Yeah.
So those little training games, you know, pick your team, Zane Sol, I'll have you.
Fun fact about Zane Sol, hijack this again.
It's going to be about you.
A little bit.
No, it's back to the islands. Turned out for Lautoka last year.
Wow. Did he?
In the OFC Champions League.
Because he disappeared to Australia. Is he state leagues?
Yeah.
Off the grid.
I'm pretty sure.
That's a good Facebook video of himself scoring free kicks. But just someone I thought was talented. I don't know what happened. He hit it, could smash a ball. Strong, fit, physical, just not never quite.
Kind of peaked at under 20s.
Yeah, got 20s, was the main man, and yeah.
But a lot of it comes down to discipline, doesn't it? And I think one of the things that I'd heard people say about you was that you always took extra special care of your body, stretching before sessions, warming down.
He still does it now.
You're not a big pisshead. You're probably, I don't know, I imagine you're eating quite well.
Turned corner now.
But
since retiring.
And you've gone through your career relatively injury free, haven't you?
Relatively so.
Do you put that down to your discipline?
Yeah, I'd say so. High school, obviously, I remember getting smashed by my good mate, John Muggeridge, in a Hillcrest boys fight derby. That was a big game in those days.
Mr. Muggeridge's son.
Yes, yep, one and only. And my dad and his dad fell out over it.
There was Pete, an incident. It was a referee.
Pete Muggeridge. Yeah, some things were said between parents that they'll regret, but they didn't really move on. Whereas me and John, probably the next year, saw each other again, shook hands and carried on, and bought each other beer ever since, and caught up a couple of times. But yeah, I think...
What injury did you sustain?
Dislocated fibula from the ankle. Oh, sorry. Dislocated fibula from my right ankle.
Sounds like a break.
No, dislocation means it's popped you out without breaking. Popped out of the ankle joint. Left me out of my year 13 or 7th form in those days season. Until a week before Nationals. Made my comeback.
Didn't think about coming back for 2nd and 3rd year 7th?
No. No, straight to university.
You
do it for your own different reasons, you know, to get academic things was LJ's reason.
College.
I'd say definitely the discipline to move on, the discipline for knowing what those little one percenters are in terms of looking after yourself, stretching, doing the right thing, eating right, recovering right. Always I thought, man, if I can do that better than him, I'm going to be better than him the next day. I might not be better yet. And always as a youngster, I'll be honest, I never made anything growing up. And there was ones like yourself, Stephen. I remember going to a camp when I was about 13 in Tauranga. And I stayed with Trent Frampton at like a homestay for the Waibok thing. And you were the same age group. I think Trent said he was about 3 days older than you or something.
Yeah.
You trained at the under-15s and we're in the under-13s. And Trent was like, oh, that's the one we want to be like. And there's ones like that. You know, like yourself, Wilkie doing the videos, things with his old man. Jezza, when I got to know him. Tinks as well, growing up with him, that were always that next tier, and I was always like, I wish I could be there, but wasn't quite. And I guess you sort
of. It's interesting because none of them ever reached the heights that you did.
Yeah, but
well,
maybe it's for the self-discipline reason.
Yeah.
So,
well, I think I do think that's a lot of it because everyone you've mentioned, I'd say, at one point growing up, disadvantaged themselves greatly by pissing it all up against the wall.
Yeah.
Big nights on the piss. But that was never really your thing, was it? You stayed away from that.
I remember getting bullied into it. Obviously, cultural things with the team and buying into it and getting hung from gutters at people's flats and kick stands by the Melbourne first team when you're 16, 17. That was part of your learning as to this is part of a team, you got to buy into it. But
you don't really see that much anymore, though,
do you? It's changed. I'm not going to lie. Captain of a team. Disappointed that you don't have just that team steamer.
Yeah,
but at the same time, I wouldn't go there and get absolutely smashed. Other members that you would know definitely would.
Yeah.
So different reasons. But
yeah, you're well placed because you're obviously teaching at Boys High and have been there for what, a decade now?
Yeah, this is my, I actually went through it, this is my 8th year there this year.
So when I look back to teams we were in, and we were all teenagers in 2003, and it was a huge, big booze culture, you know, getting on the piss on the way home from games and stuff. Not the same, obviously, for the Melbourne team that I've been close with this year.
No, definitely not.
So have you noticed year by year by year, as the students come through, a change? Or is it just the groups that are trying to be professional athletes are more professional? Or is the drinking culture overall sort of not what it
was? Good question to be fair, Stephen. We'd like some research on to go through the numbers and actually ask people how much did you drink in the season. But look at myself, as I grew older and the boys' high boys are coming into the first team, it sort of was always like, well, I'm still there.
Yeah, that must
person they look up to, and it was always hard. And I remember getting on the piss with a couple of them, being like, "Right, boys, there's a couple of rules. A, you don't talk about this at school. B, there's no social media, and you know what happens in here is a Melville thing. It's not a boys' high thing. You don't go bragging. Oh, I got on the piss with Mr. Scott. It was quite hard. And I remember the first year I did it, and it was a bit awkward. And a couple of stories came out, but there was more the case that I had thought I can't be seen as this father figure to them at school and then flip it around 4 hours later and be, come on mate, drink this down your gut.
Yeah.
You know, it was very different where I think more the expectation from parents, I think, would be there sort of in the back of my mind going, hey, you know, we trust him with you, yet you can't then do that to him on your Melville's flip side. So I think that affected things.
Mm.
At the same time, obviously with Will Kane coming in, the culture changed within the bus trips coming home, that was for sure. You know, I remember the first one, the first season, was like, here we go, boy. Just straight out of Auckland, going, hold on, what's going on here? No drinking. It's, you know, we're trying to make the next step.
Yeah.
And people sort of click very early, oh, yeah, no, fair enough. We are trying to kick on. We're not just trying to win a couple of games in Northern Prem and just, or Division 1 at that stage and stay there.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think the age it's an interesting one because when the teams that I was successful with all had big drinking cultures. Melville in the early days, Bay Olympic 2 years we won back to back Northern Premier League.
Yep.
Huge drinking culture. Yep. Glenfield was like the party team of the Northern League, but it was all the guys and it was all sort of that 25 to 30, not married, no kids, a little bit of disposable income, knew you weren't going to be a pro, so it was kind of like be good at football but then have a fucking awesome Saturday night. But these young guys coming through, like you look at that Melville team, I imagine a lot of them haven't ruled out a professional career.
I'd absolutely agree with you there, Stephen. Mm. Some of them go, right, this, if I do this, this could limit me for the next thing. What if something happens, or what if I don't do this and this recovery, or whatever, I'm not good for the next game, someone watches. So I know that for sure. There's a few there that I don't want to go out because bad image or bad rep or bad things could happen. Mm. And I know that for sure. There's a few of them like that.
The other thing that's changed from when...
To make us sound old, by the way.
We are old.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, is old. Undies in the shower. And I know that's a real bugbear of Gavin Douglas, friend of the show.
It's definitely changed over the years.
But I remember being 17, straight out of high school, and realising very quickly that you had to shower nude, and it was confronting. Now... hardly anyone does.
Is that an age? That's got to be an age thing as well.
No, I've got a theory on this.
Oh yeah,
the confidence thing.
Yeah, and here's my theory.
Have you used it thing.
A little bit. My theory is with the proliferation of pornography and pornography being so easy to access
for the young generation.
For young generation, they've got a warped sense of what's normal. and then when you realise I'm not equipped with that same machinery, your automatic assumption is everybody else is like that as well.
Yeah.
So when you get into a social situation, no one wants to not be
seen as the
seen as normal.
Again, but I guess.
Because let's
very mature point there, Dr. Seamus.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we had to pass videos around and magazines when I was
If these kids are getting influenced by porn in the showers, what's it doing for their image? What their sex lives are like?
Well, that's the flip side of it. There's all sorts of stuff.
Some stories I could share with you.
All sorts of rabbit holes.
Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff on the table now, which was never on the table when
this
was in my formative years.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's my
new world.
Yeah. That's my theory.
That's good.
Good tangent. Good tangent.
Yeah.
Maybe we can get someone on a later podcast to really dive into that.
Yeah.
Psychology review. Some people. Oh, sorry. I thought
maybe Lisa Lewis. Or...
I know some people.
let's chat a little bit about your All Whites time. Do you know off the top of your head how many caps did you have?
Statistic wise, I'm at 6. People, I've seen 10. I've seen 8. I've seen 5. Always bugbear is if someone says 5. No, I'm at 6.
What are the
6 A internationals?
Can you rattle them off?
Yeah, go ahead.
Order Thailand.
Thailand, I think it is.
No, it's not. It's definitely Thailand.
Okay.
And made my debut against there. Good story though. The superstar of Thailand. I have no idea what his name is. That was his retirement game. So there's a good crowd watching. He gets subbed off in around about the 78th minute as I got subbed on. So the crowd's in raptures as I got subbed off my international cap.
And you were thinking it was for you.
And I did give it the old... and then clapped him as he walked past me because I clicked. It's not for some making their debut. I was young and naive. I think I was 20, 21, 22.
Was that the Thailand tour that Chris James and Chris Killen arrived early on?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yep. So I just placing it in the chronology.
And tour stories arrived early. Code for something?
No, nothing. They just arrived.
No, they were the first. Thailand. They were first in Thailand from the squad.
Okay,
so I just wanted to check the time period.
Correct.
Okay,
so that was a tournament. I think there's a couple of games.
No, there's just two games. This is a little tour build up.
Okay,
random thing.
Mexico? Were you in the Mexico?
No, got invited back for that.
I was there. Yeah. I don't want to make this about me again. But
how many caps you got, Seamus?
For the All Whites?
For the management side, you must be.
I did the All Whites or all.
Well, we're going All Whites first, and then we'll go NZ teams.
I think only about 10 for the All Whites, to be honest.
Yeah, I sat on the bench a lot more than that.
Yeah. So sorry, carry on.
Yeah, thank you.
We've got two Thailand games.
Yeah, came back home, played Fiji in the dead rubber. The infamous Glenn Moss incident.
Over there.
Over there.
Yeah. Mossy got sent off and got four games.
New Zealand's football didn't appear in time. Yeah, I think so. Don't know who the culprit was, but no huge role.
Christmas holidays.
Yep. Well, it was supposed to be sitting on someone's desk in the morning and afternoon and just didn't get done. But Mossy hated that.
Yeah.
Fast forward.
Greg Draper.
Drapes.
That is one and only All Whites game in there.
I think you're right. Yeah. There's a few young guns prepping us for the under-23s or from the 23s. Moving forward, I can't remember the order, to be honest. There was a trip to Dubai. We played Jordan as a little...
Jordan, I think it is.
No. Memorable because I think Ivan Visovic got sent off in about 30 minutes, two yellows. Yet we won 3-1. It was probably my best game.
Yeah.
Think of the Confederations Cup build-up. Tanzania didn't play Botswana.
Yeah.
No, sorry.
Italy.
Didn't play Tanzania, but played Botswana.
Did you play Italy?
No, didn't get on. Good game, though. Great game for the boys to get some confidence into the
4-4
Confederations Cup. 4-3 loss, I think, in the end. Yeah. And then 17-minute Fernando Torres hat-trick changed that feel in the camp. Played the last one there, Iraq. 0-0 draw. First point of FIFA tournament. Yeah. Ricky and BT celebrated and got absolutely castrated for that.
Yeah.
And came home, obviously, World Cup qualifiers. I think that was the...
Talk us through that one, because... I think enough time's passed that we can water under the bridge. You were part of that team that qualified for the World Cup.
Yep.
That incredible night in Wellington.
14th of November 2009.
And then old Ricky's come out and said, look, everyone who was involved tonight is going to the World Cup. You were obviously part of that.
Yep.
And then didn't go. How gutted, like, that must have been crushing.
I'm not going to lie, it was, Steve. There was the days where you question, is sport on a pursue? So we won the National League with Waitak, didn't play the final. And my wife let Embers know straight after that decision was made for not going, getting in the squad, that you've ruined a boy, young boy's chance. But I had no bad feelings with Embers. It was group things. And anyway, but moving on.
He didn't play you in the final?
No.
Yeah, I remember that. That's right.
Yeah, so he fancied Tim Myers. He said Tim was training better. At that stage, I was full athlete preparation in terms of train in the morning, work, train, drive up, train in the football team things.
Yeah. So that's post-Olympics as well. So
flying fit. I remember, without bragging, clocked a couple of yo-yos. I was fit, proper things, but training a lot. And then, obviously, in the end, we talked to professional medical people, said I'd probably train too much without the performance in the week to justify things, and that's what it came down to. But the World Cup thing, that was I remember the night of that night was interesting. But afterwards, then you had Winnie the Pooh, Winston Reid, I'll come play for the Whites, and made the World Cup, Denmark heaven.
Tommy was another one.
Yeah, Tommy Smith, who, it's a good lad. I remember playing against him at school. He was at Westlake. But sort of right on all going, shit, these two top class playing in the top league. Yeah, defenders. I'm the sort of lowest camp on the rank for defenders. This can bump me down the order here. Mm. And I knew that for a while. And I remember talking to Embers because he was the assistant coach at the stage. Embers, what are you doing? He's like, you got to make sure when you're involved, be the goodest bastard, get things, make the team happy, don't complain, make sure you do everything. I remember joyful every training, part of it all. We had a training camp in Auckland, a room with Ivan. First training, game at the end of the first session, I scored the winner on. I was like, mate, you're brilliant. You got to just keep doing this. Rah, rah. And I always knew, mate, I'm always that loud. I'm going to be the number 23 if I make it here. The writing's on the wall. Mm. There was me, Cole Peverley.
Costa?
Costa was another one. Costa got done medical, assumed he was going, rang his mum, I've just done the medical for, I've done all the tetanus shots, not gone. Yeah. So there's a few rough ones. Chad Coombs is in the mix too.
I remember that.
And then... a couple of the build-up tours before that, Mexico, we played
in the States,
away in the States, and got told, we're just looking at other players for who's going to fit in.
Because Coombs,
that was his All-Whites cap.
So you weren't in those
games, no, but BT referred me, your place is in here, you've just got to make sure you're doing what you're doing. We are looking at other players because we can take 23, so, Anyway, further down the track, All-Whites things came, gone, names called, so we had a training camp in Auckland, finished on whatever day, a Tuesday.
It was an 11v11, eh? A proper...
Yeah, so we had an All-Stars game.
Yeah.
I remember I played wing-back and literally was just busting ass physically. Got dragged at half-time and I was like, shit. I don't think I did bad, but I remember stuffing across for an attacking chance and Tim Brown let me know, but other than that I thought I did fine. And he got dragged at half time. I was like, shit, is this my me gone? So anyway, we finished that. We had the next day debrief in the morning, drive home to Hamilton, get home at about 10 past 7, they always get named at 11:30, going down alphabetical quarter, Mark Paston, Ben Sigmund. You know, that was how we found out. There was no phone call. Oh, afterwards, wow. I remember I sent Brownie a message. I remember getting quite a few messages without being a big gun, but from the boys saying, like, oh, like, hard luck, you know, great lad, rah, rah, keep going. Young, I think I was 20, maybe 23, of the 2010 World Cup, South Africa?
Yeah.
Mm. Yes, just 23, turning 24 that year. It's like, okay, fair enough, but I had a lot of things teed up on, if you make the World Cup squad, we'll take you on trial, or we'll pay for this and you can come out and play for us or trial pro team. So it was pretty heartbreaking, I admit. I for a while let it go. World Cup came, went. I thought, well, I'm going to get in touch with Ricky. I want to know what I need to do, because he's obviously the coach, he's the most respected person in New Zealand football. Never heard back. So obviously I was good mates with Tim Brown. Brownie, can you get Ricky, because he's the Phoenix coach, can you get him to ring me, can you get him? So Brownie would, like, probably once a week, hey, look, you've got to get in touch with Az, he wants it to hear. Never did. And that's where I guess, without sounding too big-headed about it, I just sort of lost the respect for the man. And when he was named Wanderers coach, mate, like, that's me gone. And that was the decision, retirement from the National League, case in point, because of it. And I don't know if he ever actually knew that, but I remember getting called back into the All Whites. And then I was like, oh, here we go. Dead rubber against Solomon Islands. Played that. We won 2-0.
Is that the one up there?
Up there in Honiara.
After New Caledonia. Yep. Yeah.
The boys won and they made a raft of changes. A lot of us young boys came across.
Did you have a shirt with your name on it, or did you have
This is a good story.
This is a great story.
I had Lockhead. Yeah. So I had Tony Lockhead's two shirts and they said, oh, we'll get you two with Scott, which they did to their credits. The first time New Zealand Football did reimburse me properly. But played with Lockhead with just white tape over it.
Rolly was talking about that. There's a number of them as well.
The shirt that is hanging in the Melbourne club rooms, this is the first bit of evidence, does say Lockhead on it.
Really?
So if you ever hang it down with a blaze of glory to rescue innocent fire, it will say Lockhead on the back of that shirt. That's the one I wore, so it has got claim to fame in it, but yeah, it's interesting. And then from that, I remember sucking up the courage. I don't know what I need. And that was when Durante was back.
Yeah.
Jura was like, go ask him. You know, captain of the Phoenix. Got on a right with him. He goes, mate, we need a right back. You're pretty much the only right back in New Zealand that are right back. And this was obviously the later stage. And that's when they went, right, we're actually playing 3-5-2 or 3-4-3. And back comes Rory, Chris Wood, and Longwell Rovers came out. And, they're still better players. I mean, I'm not going to forgive the players in front of me. They deserved it more than me. They were better players, but to never have the actual chance to get, this is what you need to work on, you know, which as a coach now at school, I make sure for every player I drop, if they come and see me, I've got to have a reason or I'm not doing my job. And again, from my own personal experience, if I can't give a player that, then I'm just picking my favourites, which I've always said, if I can't, then I've cheated you. So that's something that I not admire, but I think the boys appreciate, even if they don't make it, that I'll have a conversation, actually give them what they need to do. And it's a different Brown World Cup, you know, making enough to buy a house outright.
That's some bullshit, eh? There's one thing, getting treated like that when you're sort of mid-20s and you don't have that frame of reference about how bad you're being treated. You're kind of just like in it.
That was just what it was.
But now looking back, when you're a coach yourself and you've got experience dealing with younger players, and like that's just unexcusable.
I know I'm not alone in it, unfortunately for Ricky, but yeah. Yeah, that's one thing that I definitely shaped how I coach, or how you at least talk to players and make sure that they understand where you're coming from, to say, look, this is the reason. Next year's another year. I guess high school's a little bit different, where they continue to play or they don't with whatever their life choices are from high school. But I guess, like you said, it's something I've made sure if a kid wants to know, I'll give them the time of day and talk to them, because I've been the one where he hasn't got the time of day and felt wondering why not, why this, why that, and you sort of, there's all unanswered questions there. Sat there.
That's tough.
Interesting. Good to know, though.
Yes. Oh, that's the first time I think I've ever told anyone else other than family about that, so congrats to the listeners. Special secret right there.
So did you ever, you obviously the All Whites, you know, at the top of your game, did you get close to landing a pro contract at any point?
So
actually had Tim Brown's agent, I can't remember his name, he was at the Jets. So he was like one of the media people involved in the admin side of the Newcastle Jets. And he had ties in Central Coast. And he was like, you get that, they'll take you. You go to the World Cup, they'll take you. So I had a few things riding on it.
At Newcastle?
Yep. Well, not, it wasn't a contract. It was definitely they'll take and look at you because obviously you're not getting looked at locally.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, mate, I was gunning for that. Had a few things lined up, not around the world, but through Asian market. But again, you had to make the World Cup because then they could take you on this whatever scale thing. Your classes are different. You weren't a marquee player as a right back was a bit different in those days. So in the end, went right. Talking to Jonathan Goodney, he said, mate, you just got to go for it. And I played 2009, did the preseason with the Phoenix. The whole preseason, just a little bit. This was my third preseason with the Phoenix. But got told, we played Melbourne Victory in Queenstown. All the players went to a ball. And me and one Marco Rojas, we just went to a club because we weren't invited. So we'll just go out ourselves. And this is after the game. We drew in the law with Melbourne. They had Daniel Sopp and Archie Thompson. I thought I did well. Played centre-back with Siggy. So nil all and yeah, so there's no Durante. John McCain was injured. Thinking, oh, I got in. A couple of the boys are like, mate, what's going on with you? You signed. Then they do the club songs, you know, the initiation. Marco had signed that youth contract that we all know about. That went from strength to strength. And I said, look, I'm not contracted. Leo Bertos actually said, no, don't sing. You're not going to play yet. I said, look, I don't mind singing. I'll sing every away trip if I get a contract. I don't care. But I'm not singing here to make a point. And a couple of the Aussies, I remember Manny Musket absolutely getting stuck in a couple of beers deep. Daniel Cortez called me McManimum and didn't let me forgive that moment. But I remember hitting up Ricky and I said, mate, what's the chance? And he looked me square in the eye and just said, oh, no, you're just here as injury cover because all our centre backs are injured. So thanks for filling pre-season in. And,
fuck.
And I remember that was in the hotel reception on the last morning before they flew to Wellington, I flew to Hamilton and getting... Basically, that I've just been here for 7-8 weeks, you know, bust my ass.
Yeah.
Nah, sorry, mate. But Reese Crowther was had an agent that was in.
Goalkeeper?
Yeah, goalkeeper. Reserve goal. He never got on, I don't think.
Yeah.
But
did he turn into a bodybuilder?
I think some.
No,
some,
you're thinking of Reese Keane.
Oh, that's just the under 20s. Yeah, Reese Crowther was Aussie.
Yeah. Got into a bit of trouble with the law.
Yeah, he did.
A little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, so anyway, got in touch with a guy in Norway. With an agency, and he said, yep, we take anyone, send me a DVD. I remember sending it, like my old man made it, clipped all Olympic clips, this Football for Hope, things were involved. It wasn't just like a pass like you see some of them now, but it was like moments of, so 3-4 minutes in the game where I was involved and did good things, and that got sent. And I got a phone call like the next day, mate, we want you straight away. All right, tear it up. And he had a couple of, so I went to Norway, the Adeccaligaen was the second tier, so Tippeligaen and Adeccaligaen. The two top clubs, like, mate, we want him. Go there and meet a club guy. And he's like, you're the most experienced player we've got here. This was 2010, just after the World Cup. And I said, looked at my CV thinking, like, you've got more games, you've got bigger game experience. And the first time, Song, the LFC, were top of the league, trained there for a week. They said, look, you're just not what we're after as a right back. We want this counter-attacking, just pump it long, chase, get on the end of crosses as a right back, get back and defend. I was like, look, I'm fit, but it's not my game where I want to play out and things, and they just didn't have that style, so no, it didn't fit. Second club, I can't remember what it was called, Hereford, something like that, but more Norwegian.
Yeah,
absolutely fit in, played on the turf, played out from the back, fitted in, and got injured the second day. And to get out there, it cost me something like $5,500.
I had to pay.
So on a Friday, to get there by Monday morning. So I paid $5,500, started flying that night to play for a ticket, got there, trained the first week, next club, trained, got injured, and the club went, look, we want to take you, but you're going to be injured for 4 weeks, our season's back into in 2 weeks, we can't take you injured. So I said, all right, was there another club in the line? And the couple said, yeah, but we need him to play in 2 weeks, and every physio I talked to them went, nah. So on the plane home I came, and that was, right, back to square one, I'm going teaching, I'm going back to university, and move on.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, of course, another watch thing through the Solomons came and a tour to the US and game against Trinidad and Tobago. But
were you on that tour?
Yep. Got Kenwyn Jones' shirt. Met Dwight York.
Yeah, I was on that tour as
lovely
well.
Lovely tour. Never played.
Been on a lot of tours, didn't you?
Chivas USA, got a good shirt from that.
Were you really there?
2 footers. Can you not remember the game? Chivas USA playing at LA Galaxy's out I remember.
StubHub.
Yeah. Charging into a tackle, and Jake Butler said, mate, there was no way you're pulling out of there. Everyone said, oh, here it comes. Just ran in, got a guy, and not a scuffle, but a couple of Mexican push and shove, whatever words, and just stood there like, what? But they never played the international against Trinidad and Tobago.
TNT, that was a horrible.
Yeah.
That was a horrible trip. We all had like it was a 3-3 aeroplane, and we were all either B's. Everyone was like a B or the other one, whatever the other one, E's.
Mm-hmm.
It was a horrible
B's and E's.
B's and E's. It was a horrible tour.
Yep. Craig Henderson made his debut. Good mate.
Yeah.
Didn't quite
crack it. What's he doing
now? I'm assuming he's still in Sweden playing. I'm assuming.
Dan Keat.
Keat was
Hendo and Keat. Always package. I think they're always a package.
Yeah, Dartmouth.
Those two.
Not many people appreciate how hard that is. And it's kind of unique to Kiwi footballers from New Zealand going overseas to foreign countries and trying to crack into these teams with no support network and language difficulties.
You gave it a go, didn't you?
I gave it a crack. I think Mark Young John set
me up with Kilimanjaro. I remember actually having a meeting with you at about 16 years old.
Yeah.
Young John's house.
So we went to,
trying to get us there.
Kidderminster for a week, went to Barnet for a week, and Dagenham and Redbridge for a few days.
Daggers.
But it was like 3 weeks before the season started, like the worst time to be arriving, because I've already got a pretty much settled squad, and you're basically trying to force someone out in that dressing room out of a contract. And it's, you know, money that's supporting families and all that sort of thing. So you arrive and no one wants to be your mate because no one wants to make you feel comfortable and so that they lose their position, especially the other striker. If you go in as a striker, the other strikers will sort of give you the cold shoulder. And so for a week, you're training there, you don't know anyone, you're trying to impress, but it's a tough vibe. So it's kind of like when you see someone go over there and succeed, I know it's a little bit different for Woodsy because he went over at such a young age, but still...
Yeah.
And I think his family went over as well and helped him out. Yep. But for people that go out without that support and succeed is incredible strength of character.
Well, maybe 100%. That's why your Tommy Semmys and those haven't cracked it.
They've certainly got one superstar, obviously Hamilton Project, Logan Rogerson, just come back from Germany, now playing for Auckland City. I've talked to him, coached him, mentored him. Great kid, like him the bits, but... Maybe it's tough. I remember going to Norway, no one spoke English by yourself. Maybe the same in Germany, going, shit, this is a lot tougher than you think, because your room is where you're living is smaller than this room we're talking in. And that's your life.
Yeah, Costa spoke about his time in Russia and how just brutally hard it was, because just nothing is familiar.
He's had an interesting career, eh? He was at Panathinaikos as well.
Went from there to there.
Yeah, I got some shorts. He brought me some shorts back.
You just know everyone, eh? Do you know everyone in New Zealand?
Do you know the biggest nomad that has probably gone around the world is Chris Bright. Club after
Bright.
He'd be a good one to get his opinion because he went club.
He'd be a good one to get on the cast.
Brighty, you're listening.
Move. Yeah.
We're messaging him.
He'll move.
Yeah, he'll have some stories.
Malta. Oh,
unbelievable stories.
Next time he comes and visits his in-laws in Perugia.
Yeah, Rachel. Yeah, his girl. Side girl. Same girl.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
There you go.
Do you remember when he came to Melville training a few years ago?
Oh, I do. I wanted him to sign. I tried everything to give him a sign.
We were all giving it a go.
Yeah. It was a four-a-side team, and Jezza was
Jezza
there.
Me, you, Brighty, and Jezza. It was the old boys against all the young ones. And I think we went
undefeated.
Unreal. Yeah.
Pulled the best out of everyone. Brighty could play. Yeah. Not now. He can only move by his own accounts. But
not the only one.
We were playing in those days, Steve. We were playing.
Steve can't play anymore.
Yeah. Breathe. Just gotta breathe.
Go on, showers.
Nice. Good.
Yeah, so there, to summarise where we went from the start, the Melville journey, where to be honest, the coaching aspect has issue has been aroused and interested.
Are you interested in
things? Yes and no. So I got asked early on after the Chatham Cup, and obviously straight away no.
Can I speak my truths?
Yeah, definitely.
I think that'd be a great move.
So that's what we're contemplating. Whereas in terms of family, talking to one Federico Marquez to be involved. Yeah, he's keen. He's at the same stage playing as me, going, we haven't got many years to play a coach's work. We can only play centre back because there's less running. You know, there's things like them contemplating where the club's gone to and from.
I'd hate, no disrespect to candidates that have been thing, I don't know all of them, but I'd hate to see it fall flat with someone that goes, oh, I'm coming in, I'm on this part, I'm doing this, I want to do this as a coach, and all the players go, he goes back to square one where we've probably been, Steve, going right back to Div 1, scrap away, central Div 1, middle of the league, and then 5 years down the track, go, yeah, actually, I'm ready to coach now, my girls are now older, shit, I've got no players here, we've got things.
There's an incredible amount of power having that connection to the players.
Yeah.
I think that as you move past, you know, you coach and then you're out of the game for 5 years and you try to come back in or whatever and you lose all those links you had.
Yep.
Like at the moment, you would have incredible player power.
Yep.
You know, anyone that was played last year would straight away play for you, whereas the other guys...
Some of the staff might even come back.
Well, that's what the question will be raised later on once this podcast is finished.
I'm in. Mr. Marten. I'm in. If you're in, I'm in.
Yeah, one locked in. Been for a media man.
So, what...
Anyway, Karen, okay.
That's good.
Talk to me... Because you got four kids, you just had your fourth kid.
Yep.
That must be an incredible, like, how do you fit it all in? How would you fit
that all in? That's the interesting part to go, well, school-wise, I was trying to move out of the first season for family reasons. So that would obviously...
Have you cut that out? Or is that
no, ongoing? Not yet. That's sort of, what's it, this time of year, we're sort of forecasting for next year, but there's things around the timing of sessions and all those things, how much work would it really entail... Whereas a player this year was cut out the Wednesday sessions finally and went, well, I can't do it because of family reasons. The girls all dance now on a Wednesday night, so just adds that little or extra spin on the works and it makes it too hard. So
you're dean as well, eh?
Yep. So I'm, look, days are busy, but every job's busy.
A lot of fingers and pies, a lot of moving pieces.
The bad thing is as a teacher that there's not the financial pies, so something like a coaching gig that pays. Yeah, I'm assuming, I haven't talked to Vichy about it. Vichy, if you're listening in a couple of weeks' time, hopefully there's a good package put together financially. But, you know, the teachers, I'm not going to go into all the political things, but if you get some extra financial reward for doing what the same I'm doing at school with a little bit more effort, and, you know, why not?
Can I ask you, and you might not want to answer or have an answer, but when you won national tournament with Boys High, huge for the school, puts them on the map, you know, attracts kids that want to play football and be the best. Was there any way they give you a little bonus bump in payment or any sort of...
No, so I can look it straight in the eye, so I've never got paid a cent for Boys High football.
That's mad.
We can apply and get like a petrol reimbursement when we go travel our own car out of the region, as the PPTA handbook will say, and you get a field allowance of $25 a day when you... take a team, and that's it.
So you win the national tournament, you get a handshake and a pat on the back and say, well done, mate, you can take the team again next year.
Get a blazer.
Yeah. No, that was mine from when I was at school. No blazer.
Can I ask another question along the same lines?
You can, actually.
Would it have meant more to win that national tournament as a player or as a coach?
Yeah, that's a good question. So playing group, my 2004 group, and I've talked to many people, especially at Charlie Hall, Stag doing Taupo, where we basically our team was back together. Nils Redden put it bluntly and just said,
wow, Nils Redden.
Everyone said we were the team to beat, and we lost the semi, unfortunately, for someone. Won't have the fondest memories, eh, Davey? But look, we probably should have won that, and we kicked ourselves afterwards for not doing it. But coming back as a coach, winning it as a coach, I'm not being a brag, but basically by yourself with a team that you've taken from year nine, grown. Being part of, they were good players, I'm not going to lie, they were good players coming in, but putting systems in place where they could be better and buy into things and win it. As a coach, I think that was probably my biggest domestic football thing, even winning a national league and things. Yeah, cool.
Wow.
We had players like Roy Krishna where I didn't have to do much. I remember the first final we won, Benji got the ball about 60 minutes out, beat about 8 players in the school on the way to victory. So it was different, whereas as a coach you had to get every single piece working as the best of their ability. And look, we had some good players that year.
Those tournaments are grueling as well.
Oh, absolutely. I remember Danny Hay throwing his toys at half time, going, this is absolute, I don't want to swear on the podcast, but...
You can swear, mate. Let it out.
Say what you want.
Absolute bullshit. This is a couple of games. I had to play 6 games, 5 days, and giving it all that. And I said, Danny, that's what it's been since 2000. So it's just the way it is. You have to be fit.
Yeah.
Oh, this is rough on the boys. Then we go to extra time and he's telling the ref, let's go straight to pens.
No.
Went to extra time and one of their boys blazed over the bar from about 4 yards and we thought, oh,
right,
yeah, winning it was I remember being actually speechless. So, you know, after the game, you have the debrief as a coach, everything. Just something said, a positive note to finish on to build for the next game. And I was looking in boys' eyes going. And before that tournament, we actually agreed. It was me, Liam Steffert, Johnny O'Casale, and Thomas Moucher. We all said, if we win, we'll get a tattoo. And I said, you know what? I'm in. And I had a couple of tattoos and got five now. But
did you get it?
No, I haven't. Ooh. And Keegan Hansen, to his credit, has got a Wolfpack. And the dates, was it maybe 7th November 2017, under it. And
maybe we get a sponsor on board if there's any tattoo studios.
Skinks. It'd have to be Skinks at Flagstaff, because that's where I've gone the whole time.
But, Skinksy.
I just said that. I mean, that was genuinely still around.
It's still around.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
You went, it was in Napier, wasn't it? You
yep.
won the national tournament. You win the national tournament. Incredible highlight of your career with the schoolboy team, bunch of 16, 17 year olds. Bus trip back. What's that situation?
Minivan.
Is it like
two minivans?
Because you can't drink.
So myself, Greg Hansen, Keegan Hansen, the goalie, his father, great top bloke. He's driving one. I'm driving the other. A couple of boys are 18, obviously. This year, 13 year, your last year at school, they've turned 18. Can we drink, boys? You're still in number ones. Your boys have emblems. You've got a trophy with it. You can't drink. Now, some of them were gutted, generally gutted. It's a 4-hour trip.
Yeah,
I'm getting tired anyway. We're driving back. We nearly died on the way home. This idiot driver overtook on a corner to swerve into the gravel. And some of the young boys remember it. So I had the younger van. They had their older van. And the call was made. I'm going back to the pavilion. Stu Hakenhead had obviously found out we won nationals. The Sec 11 won their nationals. We go to the pavilion, get on the Terps with a couple of their parents.
The school pavilion.
Stu Hakenhead organised it. Great lad. And so Hayden Mary, the coach of the seconds, me, Greg, the boys were all on juice. They were all like, well, this ain't the right place. But they let me know, boys, everyone's going to John. I said, everyone's going to John Clout's. So he was the captain. I was like, oh yeah, where's he live? Oh, text me the address. So we go back home. I said, Chrissy, can you drop me to John's? Definitely. She goes, yeah, you're definitely, I'll take
Sounds
it.
Sounds like a good woman.
she's absolutely top notch. Anyway, so we pick up Hayden on the way, the second 11 coach. We go to John Clout's. Some boys are still in their number ones because they haven't gone home. I got change at least. I went and grabbed John Clout's top, put that on. And I remember just absolute team steam. Second 11 players, first 11 players. We said, boys, none of these videos are getting out. You can take what you want and none get on social media, which none have.
Yeah.
But, well, not that I know. And absolutely like, we are number one. Drinking out of the cup, homemade whiskey.
Wow,
Clouty's old man Barney giving it, and Brian giving it. Sorry about Brian. Absolutely, you know, get this down, yeah. Young lads going, like, I'm not forcing you to drink, but I'm drinking it. If you want to sip, that's your call.
Thanks.
So,
that's such an interesting dynamic.
Oh, it was, but at that stage, the players, I guess, had earned that bit of mutual respect, going, right, boys, I'm one of you tonight.
Yeah.
We've won it together. It wasn't, I'm the coach, you've won it, yeah, but I'm celebrating by myself.
Mm.
Being a young coach, second year doing it by myself. I was like, wow, this is like, and even when we won national leagues, it was always win, I've got to drive home. So it was always like, up here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I remember there was only one where I went out large and Dad drove me back at about 2 a.m. in the morning from Auckland. And he stayed out to his credit, big Dave.
So is the ambition to coach professionally? Is that, would that be the dream job?
I don't think so, to be honest. I don't think so. I don't see myself being a coach for a certain team and getting paid X amount of money. No, I wouldn't say so. I enjoy the role at school where you give back to ones that are like yourselves, where you come through school, you're an honest kid that you want to do well, but you want to be guided, and you go from there. Mm. Whereas, I don't know, coaching where people expect a lot is a lot different. Parental pressures, for one.
Yeah.
If parents listen, they'll know exactly who they are, but they won't be listening, don't worry.
No one will be listening.
I don't think anyone's listening.
I'm going to listen to it, but no, I don't think there's a professional realm coaching interest in me, to be honest. Mm. But definitely, the coach in New Zealand, coach Melbourne, was definitely in the pipeline, the dream line. But
National League? Coach National League?
Probably not.
No.
Been offered like coaching in secondary school age group.
Oh, yeah?
No.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Not yet. But yeah, just like, I guess you'd say, more community based, youth based, with local kids rather than shoot off somewhere and coach people you don't know, and yeah, all those different expectations.
Mm.
Who knows? But no, I don't think it's in there.
Who knows?
Yep.
Well, I think that might be a good place. So, go ahead.
Just wanted to know about futsal.
Yeah, I see that written down there.
Yeah.
Futsal, oh, you got notes, bro.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. I'll be honest. Shoot your shot, Shay. What do you want to know?
Well, I just... Shoot. Is that felt that summer void?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll be honest, yes.
Yeah.
It did to start with last season. This season, definitely. Obviously, having someone like Braden Lissington, absolute legend of the game.
Hang on, what are we talking about? You're playing futsal.
Again,
I wish you'd do your research.
Yeah.
Yes, current in the season. Futsal, so you're training league. Last night.
Yeah, for the listeners, they might not know. So we're giving them a bit of context. So the season has started.
We are two tournaments, 3-2 to go.
They do many tournaments over weekends.
Yeah, four tournaments over weekends to work out the National League wins.
Okay.
So no, definitely. Braden Lissington got me involved last year. Said, look, you're not playing National League. You had a summer off. Do you want another summer off or do you want to come play futsal? And I said, I've never played. I've played indoor football. You kick it off the walls, bare feet, but it's different. So I want a different challenge. Go on then. So different challenge to your thinking, different technique. Really enjoyed it last year. Scored a few goals, which helped. And alleviated mate, this ain't that hard. And then basically being the old slow bruiser of the team. But this year again playing.
Did you get invited to a futsal whites camp?
No, definitely not. You watched them play. I think they're playing tonight.
No, day off today. Semi-final tomorrow.
But obviously, three teammates.
Podcast, but
that's all right.
So Wayne Bates still the only member of your extended family
to play
for the New Zealand futsal team. Shout out Wayne Bates.
Yeah. No, I won't get that far. But no, some of them are exciting on the ball, whereas that's not my game. I'm a defender, I'll be honest. My goal is to stop those exciting ones and pass to someone else that can do something.
Marvin Eakins type.
Yeah, definitely. Marvin Eakins-esque. So Marvin, if you're listening as the coach.
He'll be listening.
Brandon's got my number. Logan's
have
got
you been
my number.
Looking at my notes the whole time?
I have. I've been wondering where these other questions are coming from, so I'm quite glad you haven't asked them.
Well, these are all just other notes. No, those are about
undies in the shower.
I'll be honest.
Some drawings.
There's a lot of porn things there.
I wrote a lot of notes around that. No, the only other kind of thing. I just wondered if you were the only person that still wears lotto boots outside of Roy Krishna.
I have heard a rumour that me and Roy are still only sponsored by Lotto Ones.
I think I know that there's a third person. Yeah.
Jason Bradley.
Young Bradley Wilson.
Okay,
Bradley
Wilson.
Yeah.
B-dubs.
Yeah.
B-dubs. Good
New Zealand under-17s. I don't know whether he's sponsored, but
I think in touch on.
I know he wears.
I have tried to pass the mantle. One more order in me. Next season, and then pass the mentor and nominate someone like Luke Searle or Flynn O'Brien to.
They don't have the same profile.
No, but I didn't have a profile to start with.
Yeah.
Actually,
absolutely right.
Biggest regret in football, to be honest, turning down a Lotto paid sponsorship when I was playing at Waitak the first year.
What did you do that for?
So, made the whites. Josh Prendergast, if you know, was working at Nike. Yep, you can have Nike boots. I wore Nike boots. He gave me Nike boots, Nike shoes. Whites camp gave you more Nike gear. Hey, mate, can I get sponsored? He's like, you know what? You can. Oh, actually, budget-wise constraints, you make the World Cup squad, you can. We'll sponsor you. He's here's the contract. Squad,
really.
And then, so I basically, sorry, Rick, like, I'm after Nike. I'm not being stink, but I give him Nike gear through the All Whites. He goes, look, the offer's there. If you want to get paid to wear Lotto gear, offer's there. And Ivan Vislich was. And then, lo and behold, the World Cup doesn't come. Lotto during disappears.
Nah.
Come back and then, probably near my last year, Rick said, look, I'm moving on from Lotto, but I want you to be involved in it. Here's a sponsorship. I went, mate, I'd gladly take that and promote the brand. So still sponsored at the moment. Obviously, a lot of shoes sitting right here.
Yeah, no, that's what prompted me to write that down.
Yeah. But
we'll put a little link to the Lotto store in the
podcast. Oh, absolutely. Score Sportswear.
Yeah.
Great people involved. People
else you want
to cover? No, I think it's been great. Thanks very much for being our first guest.
What about Az? Anything you want to ask us?
No, not really. I don't think it's the right time, to be fair, Seamus. Some of these other questions might come out once we've finished. But
I'm just saying things.
Yeah, for the listeners out there, I think it's wonderful them to get more football chat and football banter. A couple of stories. I'm probably not the most interesting person. But
I disagree.
There'll be some out there that
it's been a very interesting.
We'll give some more links. Minutes. Who knows on another night? Give me probably 3 beers in 5 minutes and there'll be a few more stories come out, that's for sure, than the mature ones, and trying to bite your tongue and make sure what you're saying makes sense and is coherent for people to be interested about. So thanks for the opportunity.
You're welcome, mate. Is there anything you'd like to plug? Anything you're selling on Trade Me or you, you got futsal games you want to let the public know what's coming up?
It's going to be interesting. So the futsal series, obviously, the Waikato Rapids, as they're called now.
Where did that come from? A river.
I assume so.
I've answered my own question.
Thank you.
Colorado.
And no, not the ice hockey team.
Good knowledge.
Thank you.
I think they're MLS.
I think it's Colorado Rapids.
Yes.
Yeah. Colorado Avalanche is the ice hockey. You're right. Martin Brodeur. No, he's Red Wings. Anyway.
You're an ice hockey fan, are you?
Closet fan.
Who's your team?
Used to be Red Wings.
Same here.
Yeah, Sergei Fedorov.
I was a Brendan, Brendan Shanahan.
Oh, yeah.
Way back when.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Mate, this is going to take a turn.
Bonding.
You've got a Seahawks
tie. I am a big Seahawks fan as well, so if Russell Wilson is listening, we'll get you on one day.
Shout out Ciara.
Steve, bringing it all around.
Yeah.
Oh, look, big shout out to Glenn Reed at Lotto and Blair Dawkins that's now left Lotto, but just good people that, you know, I've got a lot of time for, people like that that obviously help you a little bit and basically try and promote things and help them as much as you can in reverse, so... For kids, if you're listening, that's how the world works. That's how it should work, where someone gives you an inch, you take that inch, but then you repay that inch in miles. So rather than give an inch, take a mile, take the inch and give a mile back. That's how it should be. So
bloody brilliant. That is a great time to end. Thanks again for your time. It has been an absolute pleasure.